garbage bags.
Government bags.
Garbage bags, and you didn't want the bag with the ones and the fives in it. It's too much kind.
Oh, we'll go back. We're gonna have to sit down just again. But okay, so there's a guy, Maurice Downs, who was in that newspaper article with Eddie and my dad and John Klassen and Henry Marzette, and they talked about. And we were talking about. You were saying it, a double exodus happened in the early '70s. So
Motown was moving out, and the Feds were moving in.
And then some big players out of Detroit, Maurice Downs, Butch Harris. What was your other guy, Reno?
Reno, that was Butch Harris.
Butch Harris gang.
Yeah, that was his man. Uh-huh.
They all moved out to L.A. and around the same time as Motown Music was relocated. And you were saying perhaps the powers that be wanted Barry in Motown.
Out of here. They were trying to, listen, Detroit was a Democratic stronghold, and it brought in all, can you imagine all those folks at Motown that were making a lot of money and donating to the same political party?
Wow, never thought about it.
So it was, people, people downplay a lot of things, but history, it's what it is. I mean, in history, when you look at their history, they try to make a hero out of Robin Hood.
Yeah. Stealing from the rich.
What did he call Eddie?
Yeah.
Robin Hood.
Called him that, and it was a true thing. They called him the fat man. Yes.
But I mean, he would come down there, and I would see him, and I didn't, at that time, I wasn't out there, but I was in high school. I was seeing him handing people money. And all my friends, man, Eddie Jackson down there got money, and he handed it to them.
Throwing it out the window.
$20,000 and $30,000
out the room,
Real Robin Hood.
In the projects.
Yes.
Real
doing
Robin
projects.
In the projects. So I never had a negative vibe about him. He was always a gentleman, and he was always somebody when you talked to, you felt like he was getting a lesson.
He's good at that.
Very good, and when that Butch Harris thing jumped off and I got out.
So let me set it up. So Butch Harris, this guy Reno, big guys out of Detroit.
Right.
They've relocated out to Cali. You've relocated out to Cali. Some of the other Motown people, Smokey and that, everybody's kind of, by this time, this is 73, so by then, Motown is now headquartered in California. Butch Harris is still a big guy, and there was a mysterious, his death came at a mysterious day, a very mysterious, supposedly, as far as the newspapers
he
said,
was murdered.
That it was a accidental police shooting.
He was murdered. I understand.
But you were actually...
I was in the building.
Okay, so tell us about it.
And when we went to trial, he had about 20-something shots in him, bullets. And from what I understand, he was asleep. But they had a gun, they placed it around him, said he pulled a gun, but he was asleep. And
he may have been set up with some undercover female agents also?
I took food downstairs to him. And it was two undercover police. All that came out in court. I had no idea. Because at that time, everybody from Detroit was going to the Roxy that weekend. And because of the dramatics were in town. So, when that people from home come, we all pile in. And then when all that stuff went down, when they killed Butch, next thing I know, I'm locked up in jail because I'm from Detroit. My name's Harris. And then I get there, I see all of these folks in jail, in cells from Detroit. Some of the band members of the dramatics, one of the guys that sang with me. They was trying to just grab up everybody from Detroit. And one of the first things they said, you got the most to lose. So we're going to have to get some confirmation from you about what's going on. I said, I can't tell you nothing about what's going on. I don't know. Well, you helped this guy get into this apartment building. Well, that wasn't Butch's apartment building. That was my other friend Reno's apartment. Butch was just happened to be there. That night. So they had been following them. You know, and I had seen him a couple of times, but I had no idea. I wasn't watching for nobody.
And you say Eddie had told you a message for Butch and them.
Before you understand, I went to California. Eddie had told me, said, man, you know, Joe be with you, man. So you need to tell Joe, you understand, poor Butch, it's coattail that you understand, the feds is watching him. And I told him that.
I told him.
And like I said, you understand, they had been on his ass for a while. They had been on him, you understand.
Yeah, because Butch had told me, said, well, man, I'm through with that. I ain't even in that shit. I'm a whoop, 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 whoop. So, I mean, that was one of the dark spots in my career. I had a number one record out.
And so what was that? Which one of your number one records was that time?
You Plus Me.
You Plus Me.
Yeah.
With?
Taka Boone.
That was number one at the time of this incident.
No, well, it was number one when I got locked up.
When you got locked up.
See, so I mean, I had to fight it for 2 years, 3 years.
To clear up this.
Trying to get it off my back. And when it came out, my appeal was over. So we go back to court, and my appeal was denied. So I go to jail directly. I've been in jail 6 months. When I walk into Lum Park, coming out was Eddie Hazel. Now, he played guitar for me at one time, but he was a guitar player for Funkadelic. And as I was going in, he said, where you going, Joe? What you doing here? I said, I'm going to jail, man. Where you been? So he exchanged and hooked me up with some of the guys there that he met in there, and I got his job. So nobody never would see me all day. I was an orderly at night, and all these guys get up and go up to the Air Force Base or out in the fields and work. So, I mean, I was in jail maybe 5 months and sitting in the TV room, and all of a sudden the they was doing a repeat of a Soul Train show, and who was it featuring? Undisputed Truth. They didn't get a chance to get into the show. It came on. And today we got Undisputed. Now I'm up there singing and every head in the place turned around and looked at me. Guys didn't know that was me. And I was like,
Speaking of Soul Train, so what do you think? What are your memories of Don Cornelius?
Very good.
Good guy?
Very good. Don Cornelius, when we were on tour with the Jackson 5, our promotion man, Weldon Arthur McDougal, was a very good friend of Don Cornelius. Don Cornelius had that show in Chicago. And when we went to, he went off like this. Don Cornelius called at Weldon Arthur McDougal, who was a top promotion man at Motown, and said, man, look, Sears is fixing to drop me. We need a national known act on here so that I can get some distance. And he said, well, what about Undisputed Truth? He said, what? They got the number one record. Yeah. He said, well, they can be there. They'll be in town tomorrow.
Boom.
We went and did that show. It was in a room no bigger than that little space over there. And you had all those kids around us right there, and we did that show. James Brown saw the show. We had a number one record. James Brown saying, well, why are they doing that show? He called and he did the show the following week. The OJs followed James Brown. After that, it was in Chicago, they was in LA. Gave him a whole new life.
Wow.
You know, and Weldon called me and said, man, I told Don Cornelius we saved his life. And he said, thanks. He said, we're going. So we did a lot of, I did a lot of Soul Train. I think I was on there maybe 8 or 9 times. But Soul Train, that was another one of those idioms that changed everything for us musically. It brought us to the forefront. It evened us up with my very good friend Dick Clark with
Vince.
So I mean, you know, and then when we do things, we always put that twist in it.
Yeah.
So I mean, you got people that are artists and people in your show and in the audience that got personalities. Those were the keys for Don Cornelius with the Lockers and Fawn and Shabadoo.
Big Boss Filmworks and Big Boss Books presents Courtney Robert Brown Jr.'s follow-up to the book Motown Mafia. Motown Mafia, Big Man on Campus.
My internship was kind of in how the world of international finance and international criminal activities overlap.
Corey Black Sr. wanted Corey to go to school to bring legitimacy to the family, but Corey had other plans. While in college, with the help of his friends and his girlfriend, he starts and grows a successful drug operation.
5 minutes later, two agents, well, now I know they were agents, but at the time I see two guys go to the right, another two guys start walking towards me. They stop at my seat and they go, "Grab your bags, DEA, come with us." Needless to say, this is not the fun part of being an intern.
Corey finds himself conflicted with his responsibility to running the family business and his obligation to his college studies. However, he'll have to make things work in his favor if he wants to remain the big man on campus. The names have been changed to protect the guilty and the innocent.
I'm taking economics and business 101 and marketing. And you know, your economic teacher's telling you about a business plan and how you get a small business loan. And you know, it's kind of the hypocrisy of the world, because I'm like, that ain't how the real world works.